Howdy, this is Mackenzie Franklin from SideGame LLC here in Colorado Springs, Colorado. And today we're going to be continuing a top 10 list, and that is the top 10 more board games that I want to live in. So, previously on this channel, I did a collaboration with Tia from Takaijo, and this is a continuation of that list. Now, in that video, I'll link to it in the description, we covered our number 1 through number 5, both of us, so make sure you go check out that video, check out Tia's channel over at Takaijo. But here, I want to talk about 10 more games that just couldn't make it on that list, and I thought there were just so many good board game worlds that, man, I thought that this is one that I really wanted to jump in. Now, just a heads up, one quick caveat for the list, none of these games are any IP games, so these are all games that are, you know, the worlds in them exist in that board game. And so, with that being said, let's go ahead and jump into the list with number 10, which is actually number 15. And number 15 is going to be the game Santa Monica. So Santa Monica is a fantastic theme. So right off the bat, this game just breathes Southern California. You're on the beach here, you are chilling, and you are just, you know, gathering dudes around the beach, moving around to places, setting up your own personal boardwalk, and building out your own personal beach in this game. You have sand dollars that you can use as a currency, but really you're just trying to really orchestrate this perfect beach. And the reason this is an awesome game that I want to live in is it's so chill. Who wouldn't want to live on a oceanside town? This boardwalk theme is great. This world is wonderful, and everybody looks like they're having a great time. And this is a very relaxing, calm game, so I think that that would be a perfect place to live in. So that's my number 15, Santa Monica. Now, number 14 goes to Underwater Cities. Now, I was kind of torn between this one and Terraforming Mars. They both have similar themes where you're constructing these large places to live, essentially. You are basically terraforming an area, and in Underwater Cities in particular, you are terraforming more parts of the Earth for human habitation. So in particular, you are doing under the ocean. Now, the reason I chose Underwater Cities over something like Terraforming Mars was this in particular has you doing something that is going to be something you can actually see and witness. In Terraforming Mars, that one, you're going to see things generation after generation. But here in Underwater Cities, you get to see the fruits of your labor pretty quickly. Yes, these projects are big and grand in scale, but ultimately they're going to be done maybe in like 5 to 10 years, which is something that you can actually witness and see the fruits of your labor. Yes, it's cool to leave an awesome legacy in something like Terraforming Mars. The big projects, when they happen, would be insane and amazing, but I think that the tangible area that is Underwater Cities, I think, is just super fascinating and super awesome. I love the ideas behind this game, and personally, I just really like the underwater theme, and I think any way that we can explore more of this mysterious surface of Earth is something I'm game for. So that's my number 14, Underwater Cities. My number 13 goes to the game Legacy of Dragonhold. And this is a storytelling game that is just absolutely delightful, and I'm just going to jump into it now. That's the reason it's on this list. So this is set in the world of Runeterra. So this is a Fantasy Flight Games property. This is where they have a lot of their fantasy kind of theme. But this one in particular, straight from the get-go, it introduces you to a character creation system that really allows you to be who you want to be and just kind of create the story for yourself. And it feels very open and inviting. This is a fantasy world that is just fun to explore, fun to talk to the characters, has charming people that you get to know and get to work with, and the settings are just wonderful and gorgeous. This is a world where I just want to go and chill in the inn and eat all of the delicious foods that they're talking about. Oh man, this game honestly has inspired me to actually look up and find cookbooks that I found really interesting, and I actually have a pretzel recipe that I'll hopefully be able to get to make tomorrow, so looking forward to that, but I just think that this is a world that I want to hang out in. I want to be here. I want to sit by the fire of the inn, and I want to go adventuring with my friends. So this is Legacy of Dragonhold, my number 13. My number 12 is going to go to the game Bargain Quest. Now, this is a little bit different. Yes, it's a fantasy world, but in Bargain Quest, you don't play as the adventurers. You play as the shopkeepers, and your whole deal is you're trying to sell things to the shopkeepers here. So you're trying to sell things as the shopkeepers to your patrons. So they come in full of money, and you're going to sell them goods that hopefully they're going to take and take down these monsters that are terrorizing the land. So right off the bat, this is a very different take on the fantasy genre, and I think it's super refreshing. I love the idea that you are, you know, you're gathering all these adventurers in, you're hearing their stories, you gear them up and you outfit them and then you send them out, and you're kind of like a sponsor, right? And you're hoping hoping that they do well so that you just promote more business for your store. And I think that is super fun. I love how quirky the different characters are. I love the different art styles and just the world in general, I think, seems like a blast because, yes, you get to experience all of this amazing fantasy stuff, particularly the battle and the adventures and the heroes, but you're not necessarily being put in super bad danger, but you still get to enjoy all the things that come with this wonderful world. So that is my number 12, Bargain Quest. My number 11 is going to go to Atlantis Rising 2nd Edition. Now, this is such a beautiful game. This has you playing as the Atlantean people. You are a head counselor, and it's your job to gather your followers and prepare to evacuate the city and hopefully escape to someplace where the flood cannot get you. So you have all of this advanced technology, and right off the bat, the reason this game draws me in is because it is all about working together. You have a crisis, but everybody can work together and with camaraderie escape this situation and start something new. So you get to experience and use this incredible technology to avert crisis, and I think that would only make your civilization that much stronger if you succeed. So yes, it would be very scary. Yes, it'd be terrifying, but before or after the cataclysm, I only see positives here. Before it happens, you're going to have a great time on this wonderful peninsula with, you know, all this advanced technology, knowledge, etc. And if you do manage to escape, then you are going to have an even better time with a stronger foundation coming from this excellent group and community that has survived this hardship. So that's my number 11, Atlantis Rising 2nd Edition. Now, my number 10 is going to go to Cloudspire. Now, this is a game where you play as a faction that live in the clouds, and you are competing over this resource called the Source. It's an energy source that just kind of powers everything in the sky. And I think that this is really cool because these factions, these tribes, they are all so drastically unique. So right now, there are 7 different factions that you can play as, and there's also all sorts of mercenaries that are going to be populating the islands, and each has their own different way of life, different story. The game itself has a campaign book that covers a lot of the narrative aspects and the different ideas and cultures of these different characters, going from the Narora, which are these blue guys here, they are energy people. They actually eat the source and eventually become it, to the giants, who are very focused on their brute strength and battle. And it's really interesting, just the entire world and civilization. So seeing how this would be and just seeing these large groups, these armies fighting, I think this would be super fascinating to just kind of, you know, be a historian in this time or something like that. So Cloudspire, extremely fascinating. All these different cultures, civilizations, super cool. That's my number 10. Now, my number 9 goes to the game Tidal Blades Heroes of the Reef. Now, Tidal Blades has you playing as a contestant to become the next Tidal Blade. It's your job to protect the island from these giant monsters, but first, you must prove your worth, and I think that is such a cool setup. So right off the bat, you are set up on these different islands, and you're going to be going around from island to island competing in tasks, and these tasks are essentially just tournament legs, and each of these tournaments here is going to, you know, prove your worth. You're trying to impress a judge, you're trying to slay monsters that are coming into the fold, and hopefully working with your teammates while also showing them up. So I like how this is this really fascinating tournament theme, and the characters themselves in this game, they're all just so different, so unique. They come from all these different parts, and this world is very rich. So as you can see, just in the box here, it's got a map of what's going on. So you are mainly going to be in Naviri here, and you are preventing those creatures from the fold from coming in. So cool. I love this. The characters are robust. The challenges themselves look fun and exciting. And who doesn't want to throw down in the Chronosim here? So I really enjoy this theme. I love that tournament vibe. Fantastic. That's my number 9, Tidal Blades. My number 8 goes to the game Spirit Island. Spirit Island has you playing as the spirits that are protecting this island from colonials from coming in. So they are trying to blight the island, and it's your job to protect it, as well as the Dahan who live here. And I think that you have 2 options in this game to be awesome to live in. The first person you could be is the Dahan, the villagers. So you could be people that are witnessing these crazy feats of strength, the jungle, hungry, talons of lightning, being able to witness those, that just sounds amazing. Like, these could be once-in-a-lifetime things, or, I mean, at the rate that people play this game, you could see this multiple times in your lifetime. Just being able to bear witness to these incredible feats of strength from these titans, and knowing that they are protecting you, that is so cool. The other thing is, you could be one of the titans themselves, these spirits. How awesome would that be, to harness this power in order to, you know, protect protect people for a good cause. I think that is so cool, and I think that this is one that sounds like a blast to be in. So that's my number 8, Spirit Island. Now, my number 7 goes to the game of Fleet the Dice Game. So very drastically different here. Fleet the Dice Game has you playing as the owner of a fishing company. You are going to be harnessing the power of all these fishing boats as opposed to something like a large spirit, but you are going to hopefully be fishing as much as you can, catching them, building buildings, frying them up, and doing what you can to make the most money and eventually the most points. Now, the reason that I think this sounds fantastic is, how cool is this? So this is something that I've never really thought of being something very interesting, but just being able to jump into a world where you are proficient at this kind of large-scale fishing sounds like a blast to me. So fishing is something that I've always been a little bit interested in, but just I have not been very good at. So I was in Boy Scouts when I was younger, and oh man, I was not very good at fishing, even though I went a lot. But you know, having something this successful, being able to run this and catching lobster and cod and clams and swordfish, this just sounds so cool. And in this case, you have a whole team behind you. And not only are you, do you have your team that's working for you, but you also have all of your friends who are your competitors. I think that this just sounds so pleasant. And then you all come back to your little coastal town in the harbor afterwards. And this just sounds like a fantastic time. So really interested in just fishing as a whole. And it's something that I wish that I could do. And, you know, I think that'd be fun to try again. But I think that this is just so neat. And I think it'd be a blast to have something like this. So that's my number 7, Fleet the Dice Game. Now, my number 6 is Forgotten Waters. Now, Forgotten Waters has you playing as pirates, but not just any pirates. Magic has been unleashed on this world. So not only do you have the swashbuckling and the seven seas at your feet, but you also have all of this magic that has been infused in the game. You have dragons and creatures and sea serpents and krakens, and the game displays it beautifully. You have these large pictures that just show everything that's going on. And the narration of this game, the voice acting, it's so on point. It draws you in. Half the time, you're not even playing this game for the mechanics. You're playing it for that story. And wow, does it not pull you in? This seems like this is ideal. It's all the fun of pirating with a mix of fantasy, but without the scurvy and the starvation and, you know, the terrible disease. This is something that sounds fantastic to me. I mean, I'm not going to show you any crazy spoilers or anything like that, but just, you know, exploring on the map, you've got your whole crew with you, and everybody has their own kind of kooky backstory that's kind of brought out as the game plays. What a blast. What a way to experience time with your friends. This is fantastic. So that's my number 6, Forgotten Waters. And that's the list. So those are top 10 more board games that I want to live in. Once again, for numbers 5 through 1, please go check out that list that I did with Tia over at Takaijo, and make sure you're subscribed to her channel as well as my channel for more videos like this. So I do really appreciate it. Thank you so much for watching Side Game Strong.